This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the performing arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
Hello, and welcome to the Hexagon Studio. This is Marjolaine Fournier. I'm sitting here with Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler, and today a subject that many people talk about, not many people know, and not many people have listened to this music. We're talking about Wagner. And I have to tell you, Jean-Jacques, that for myself, I haven't played very much Wagner. I haven't listened to very much Wagner, and I had a strong prejudice against Wagner for everything that I heard. And once, now I'm talking a lot, but then I'll let you loose. At first, I started reading many months ago about this guy, and I couldn't get into it. The first problem was that I was playing Tristan while I was studying, and it's impossible to focus when Tristan is playing. It's impossible. Impossible. But also, the books that are written are so arid, are so opinionated also, and they all have to deal with, was Wagner an anti-Semite? Was this reflected in his operas? Before talking about what Wagner really wanted, which was to create a work, he even had a word for it, which you will remind me, but it's like the world in a piece of art. That's what he wanted to create, an opera where the music and the words were so knit together.
Yeah, and where drama and music were knit together also. Yeah. And he called it a Gesamtkunstwerk.
There it is. So once you start to get to know this guy, it's not that you forget things, that you understand him more. He was so intelligent. And musically, he evolved so fast. I listened to one of his first overtures, the Liebesverbot. It's ridiculously French, or very light, or very, it sounds maybe like Offenbach and Weber at the same time. It's very, very light, operette almost.
It's Shakespeare.
Yes.
It's Measure for Measure.
And then, a few years, a decade later, you have Rienzi, a change, big change, and then you have the Phantom, the Flying Dutchman, mm-hmm. the evolution, and then Tristan. My goodness, what a man! So you have been to Bayreuth about a zillion times. You have listened to a lot of Wagner. You know a lot. And you've worked these questions that I had to work through. You've done that also. So tell me.
I before I tell about that, I want to start with something that's like an anecdote. I was making a movie on somebody who had saved 669 children during the Second World War. His name is Nicholas Winton. when Nicholas died last year at 106, and I was interviewing him in his British garden when he was about 90 years old, and it's the first time I met him, in fact. And after the interview was finished, the people of the Austrian television were packing their things and all that. And we were talking about music. And I told him I have been every year to Bayreuth since 1976, and I have seen the Ring Cycle more than 50 times, and most of the big operas more than 50 times. And he looked at me. He was of Jewish extraction, and he looked at me and said, "Do you know something? Don't tell anybody. I love Wagner." And I do think this is an extraordinary sentence. Don't tell anybody. I love Wagner. So I'm biased. I love Wagner. I was 15 when I saw the Ring Cycle for the first time in my life, and he has never left me, because each time I go and listen to one of his operas, I find new things. There are so many layers to his music. When you know how to listen to this music, you are in for a most extraordinary feast. And one of my colleagues and somebody I know well, Anthony Tomasini of the New York Times, wrote in one sentence, "How did such sublime music come from such a warped man?" Such a warped man. Yes, yes, he was intelligent. Oh, yes. No composer in the 19th century, and perhaps even in the 20th century, has been so interested in philosophy. But at the same time, he was a megalomaniac. He was paranoid. He was egocentric. He was a real anti-Semite, like most of the people in the 19th century were. And eroticism was central to his life. So you have this man. We have to talk a little bit to see where he came from and how all this became the way it was. But nobody has taken as much space in the 19th and 20th century as Wagner. When you start talking about it, that everybody talks about it, but nobody knows him. It was a very interesting statement, because we all cling to the few clichés of Wagner. And these clichés are very strong, and they seem not to be going away. But there is only one person of whom one has written more about in our society than Wagner, and that is Jesus Christ. The works about the Bible and the works about Wagner are at the same level, and it is rather interesting. And you say it's complex. It is complex. That's what I was trying to say in the very beginning. As a listener, you go, and when you listen well, you say to yourself, "I've never heard this before. What is happening? Where this conglomeration of notes come from? These harmonies come from?" And in a way, it's very simple music. It goes straight forward. It goes straight forward. But it goes straight forward. It takes you by the heart, and it takes you by the guts, and it takes you by your intelligence. And if there are good directors, because it was a Gesamtkunstwerk, then suddenly everything explodes all sides and you walk out of it. Each time I go to listen to a Ring Cycle in Bayreuth, I come out a different person.
So the Ring Cycle, which comes after the
up to a certain point.
You're right. It's composed of four full-length operas.
Let's go very quickly through the history, which you started a few minutes ago. And I do think this would be interesting, because it is all one within the other, because there are a few fundamental themes that we will try to get out of his works. Now that we have dealt with the clichés, or almost. So we are in the beginning of the 19th century. And as much as the year 1810 was an important year, because you had the birthdays the year before of Mendelssohn, then Schumann, Chopin, all 2000, around 1810, of course. 1813, you have two births, the two great opera composers of the 19th century. You have Wagner, 1813, Verdi, 1813. In countries, each of them, that they will represent so fundamentally. Two countries that don't exist yet. Germany doesn't exist and becomes Germany during that time. Italy, that doesn't exist and becomes Italy as we know it today, during the time of Verdi. Both of them very politically involved. Those two 1813 births are right on time. And they will be the flagships, the musical flagships, which was in the 19th century so much more important than in classical music today. A composer today composes works, but they don't change the direction of the government, or they don't change a revolution.
Now, Verdi became elected. He joined mainstream politics.
Yeah, but Wagner was unelectable. He was unelectable.
And he got quite punished, which is
he almost went to jail, of course. And he had to leave Germany for 11 years. But it was not a bad idea, because he went to Switzerland and he composed the Ring Cycle, Tristan, and the Meistersinger of Nuremberg, which is not bad.
And we're actually touching on one of these false knowledges, which I thought he was an extreme right.
No, he was extreme left.
He was extreme left. He was quite a socialist at the beginning.
But extreme right, that has to be, you know, and extreme left has to be talked about. It has to be modulated, as we would say in music. Mm. He is, it's extreme that is the danger.
Right. Right.
And it's true that he was on the barricades and things. Had to give a moment. Let's get back. 1813 and the political situation during that century is important, because they symbolize, each of them, the creation of nationalism. And they're both into it. And I do think this is important if one wants to understand also what Wagner is. So, we're not too sure who his father is. And it could be Friedrich, who dies very young and who is not very present, because Wagner's mother, gets married to Ludwig Geyer, who is an actor, a poet, a painter, in 1814. So there is a misunderstanding there. And one of the things is that in all the controversies, it was said that Geyer was half Jewish. So there is a very interesting tie for those that are interested in those kind of things.
He loved that man a lot, eh?
He loved that man very much, because he's the one who brought him to the arts. He had it in him, of course. He had it in him. But there was, and Wagner, in the very beginning, wanted to become a writer for theater plays. And that was the influence, of course, of Geyer, who marries the mother in 1814. So the little one was only 1 year old. That has been his real father, and education-wise, everything. So at 20, he writes a symphony, which I know, and which I bought right away after having heard the Ring Cycle at 15, you know, one of those long playings, and an overture on Faust. Yeah. There you go. You know, Faust is there at 20. At 21, he becomes chorus master and is writing Die Feen, which is the first opera. First grand opera, because that was the la mode. That was the thing to do at that time. And it's the first grand opera. Now, not many people will be, one is not very much represented these days, which is unfortunate because I have heard the two next operas. It's the only opera I have never heard live, Die Feen. But 2 years later, you know, he's 23 years old. He writes the Das Liebesverbot, and you have been talking about Das Liebesverbot already. It is a comedy. And he called it a grand comedy, against like grand opera, grand comedy. Mm. I heard it in Dresden played, where Wagner was born. Wagner is very present already in there. You were right. Between Offenbach and Weber, I find lots of Weber in there. Weber is really, the man who's standing in front of Wagner when he's learning, and he gets into that new work on Measure for Measure by Shakespeare, with lots of changes in it, and interesting work. It's not the Wagner I like very much. Well, it's not the great Wagner, but it is certainly a very, very present Wagner already.
And you can't really guess that he's just 20, just starting.
23. I mean, no, one cannot guess that. No. He's already a mature composer. He takes himself very seriously. You know, this is, I wish I had a little bit more of his, certitude, about how good he was.
Apparently, part of his reputation was that side of him was quite annoying. Is his certitude in himself, his confidence, his need also to explain himself to everybody.
Very interesting, isn't it? It's part of the people that think they're marginal, mm-hmm. and want to prove themselves. The people that want to prove themselves are very annoying. Yes, you're right. I mean, that's let things be and go forward.
Now, I don't know if I'm going to throw you off track. But what I find also interesting, because he was in such need of justifying himself and explaining and describing his thoughts, he wrote it all down for people to read.
Remarkable writer.
Yes. And so he says, well, he loved the Greek theater. So at first his thought is the orchestra should be sort of like commenting, like the Greek chorus. Then he thinks, no, maybe the music should really support the text and the emotion. But by the end of this first period, the words have to come after the music. They have to, because the music carries everything. The music holds, without the music, it's hollow.
So you're touching on five grand ideas in that one sentence. Let's take one of those. His interest in... before we go on with the history, but I want to touch on it because the question is a very profound question and it touches on really what Wagner is about and why it's such a rich, creative person. He's very interested in the Greek theater, certainly. And like the Greek theater, in his later works... he will do what Shakespeare does in a way also. When you start a work, you start very close to the resolution of that work. You tell what it is going to be. You know that these things are going to happen. You're just not telling a story. You start by the end, in fact. Or almost by the end. In Tristan, because this is the work we are focusing on a little bit today, in Tristan, we know that these two people love each other. We know that this is going to be forbidden. Liebesverbot. Yeah. That this is going to be forbidden. We know that there will be a resolution to it, and Wagner will give his resolution to it, and that is, of course, that is the redemption, which is central to his work. And so he starts with that. Wagner starts always with the end. If I can give a second example, the Ring cycle. Where does he start? He starts to write about Siegfried's Tod, the death of Siegfried. And then he says to himself, he's writing the text, he said, I have to tell people what happened before. I have to tell his youth. So he writes the young Siegfried, which later will become Siegfried. And Siegfried's Tod will first become Götterdämmerung, the demise of the gods. And once he has done young Siegfried, he said, I have to tell where he comes from, who are his parents. And you have the Valkyrie. And then he said, but the parents, God has to come in somewhere. So he writes the work, that prelude of the gods, and it's called Rheingold. And then he starts working, creating the music for Rheingold. And then he goes backwards again to the demise of the gods. From the gods to where the gods have lost their godliness. Where gods became human beings, in fact. And so that whole thing. So it's extraordinary. In that century, there is another great author, Marcel Proust, in the 20th century. Marcel Proust wrote also from the, you know, from the back, going towards the beginning. I think very often, when you have an idea, you put that on paper, and then you say, okay, I have to explain this idea. And then you go backwards. And that is the great creativity of Wagner. Shakespeare's plays, in the first lines, you know what is going to happen. That the plot very clearly is set at that moment. Wagner does that too. That's one of the five things you have mentioned in that one sentence. And I want to, and we could go on. But let me go on now with the history. Because it becomes very, very interesting. The year after Das Liebesverbot, he's going to Riga, one of the Baltic states, you know, Riga, and he becomes director of Riga's theater. And what does he create? Rienzi. Now, Rienzi is an interesting work because that has to do with the power. And it's another of the, I was talking a few minutes ago about the search for redemption. The other great theme of the works of Wagner is going to be the tension between power and love. The whole Ring cycle is about that. The whole Ring cycle is about power and love. The one who has the ring has power and loses love. When you lose the ring, you can reconquer. Love. So it's one of the big themes that goes through the whole Ring cycle. But it's also true, you know, you have the power of King Mark, who is the official husband. Not consumed marriage. That's what's being said. Not consumed marriage. And then you have that extraordinary love between those extraordinary in all senses of the term of these two people who know that they're in for it to the end and for the end.
Thank you.
so that even when they take by mistake, they think they're going to die, but they took by mistake a love potion.
There's a wonderful word in French, l'amour à mort.
Oui.
L'amour à mort, don't people call orgasm small death? La petite mort? We are, you know, the internal explosions that happened, and here it's put at the idealistic and large one. And that's what this music says. This is an extraordinary, the music of Tristan is an extraordinary explosion, internal explosion. It's eroticism made music.
Yeah, there's nothing like...
And there is nothing that takes you that far away within yourself as this music. So let's come back before we get too far into Tristan, because we'll get to Tristan in a few minutes. So he's in Rienzi, and it's about power. But at that time in 1839, he has to run away because he has problems with creditors. He has always had problems with creditors. It is as if the world owed him the money so he could create his masterworks. There are thoughts to that, and there are books written about that, and we won't get into that too much. So he takes the boat, he goes through that water, and he gets into a full storm. A full storm on that boat, and he goes to London. In London, he has to get away, and then he gets into Paris, and his wife Mina and himself are poor, like anything. The Paris period is the worst period of his life, because Paris is glorious. Paris is the city to be at. That's where the musical world is together. And that's where Meyerbeer is the head of the opera and has his grand operas performed. And he's on top of the world. And Halévy is the other one who has created the opera La Juive. By the way, both of them are Jewish. And, you know, there is that wonderful time for the Jewish people after the French Revolution, where equality was one of the goals of the French Revolution, and where even the Jews were able to do all kinds of other things. So it's an extraordinary moment. And then, of course, that for centuries, all these things that have been kept back by the Jewish people who tried to survive, and tried to survive sharpens intellect, intelligence, and the artistic part that is part of the, that has always been part of the Jewish people. So it all comes out, and the composers. And on one side in Germany, you have this very rich Mendelssohn. And in Paris, you have the man who's running the world. And Meyerbeer is very nice to him. He's not very nice to Meyerbeer. He can't stand him. He can't stand him because he's so successful. And this is a very important period, because it reminds the period of Adolf Hitler, who was as poor as anything, who was trying to create his paintings, was trying to get into the, a few decades later, of course, and the Kloss period, we call it, and like Wagner, Hitler was ferociously conscious of his neglected genius. And both are sons of petty officials. So, you know, if you think his father was, working for the police force there. And both of them are brought to the edge of their solutions and are very, very poor. And they want to take revenge on society. There is a kind of parallelism for those that like to see the success of Wagner during the Nazi period. Although the 19th century was a very different century, people couldn't stand the newcomers.
Well, that sounds familiar, isn't it?
Yeah. Isn't it? People can't stand newcomers, and you know, where is my space? And he, being so paranoid, egocentric, megalomaniac, you know, well, it turned into anti-Semitism. So let's come back to where he is. He's poor. He's in Paris. He cannot have his new works produced, and his new work is partially, in fact, you know, we could talk about this until the end of our meeting, The Flying Dutchman.
Yes.
The Flying Dutchman is also is about redemption, but it's also the Wandering Jew, which is the Christian view, of course, of Jewishness. It is also that famous storm he went through, and the tempest, the storm in the Flying Dutchman is
fantastic. Yeah, it's fantastic writing.
And when he does that in 1843, well, Germany in Dresden, they will premiere it. Not Paris. So he goes back to Germany, 1843, and then by 1845 he completes Tannhäuser, and we are on the borderline of the great works, of course. The Flying Dutchman has elements in there of grand opera. The Flying Dutchman has duos. Real duos, and not two units singing each their text, like in the later operas. So you have the Flying Dutchman, and then he gets into Tannhäuser, and then Lohengrin the year afterwards, 1848. Lohengrin is 1848. And again there, it has to do with redemption, and with love and power. And in 1848, of course, as you mentioned already in the very beginning, he's on the barricades, and he is part of that group, the Young Germans, who are for the liberation of the tyranny of political and religious authority. And it's also a very social convention and about sexual liberation, and he gets very much into the theories of philosophers and of thinkers like Proudhon, who's an anarchist. Oh, yes, it's a very interesting period, 1848, but he has to flee, not this time because of debts, but because of the police going after him, and he will disappear from Germany for about 11 years. And where does he go? Of course, you go to Switzerland. And so when he is in Switzerland, he will immediately, you know, in 1854, he will start thinking about the Ring Cycle. Oh, in 1848, he thinks about the Ring Cycle. He talks about it already. In 1848, he talks about it, and then by 1854, he will compose the beginning of the Ring Cycle, and of course he writes first the text. It takes 26 years to write to compose the Ring Cycle. There's a big period in between of about 10 years, but you know, let's say about 16, 17 years. For the Ring Cycle, because he stops midway. I can tell you also why he stops midway, and there are all kinds of reasons that conglomerate and that stop the Ring. But what he does is he writes, as I mentioned, Götterdämmerung, Siegfried, Walküre, Rheingold. And then he composes Rheingold, Walküre, Siegfried, and after the two first acts of Siegfried, suddenly he stops. He stops. And he said, well, why does he stop? There are all kinds of reasons for that. People said he fell in love with Mathilde. I have my doubts about the synchronicity of those things. First of all, he stops writing after two acts because he doesn't know what to do with the last act, putting in bed the aunt and the nephew.
Mm.
Even him, with his theories of sexual liberation. A few years later, much more conservative, and the times were very conservative. And he didn't know how the public would take that. So he puts it away for some time. At the same time, he meets all kinds of people. And he meets Mathilde. But I do think that great creators create, in this case, love, and then fall in love. Because they have created love. He had love in mind. And then, of course, as you know very well, because I know you have been reading Schopenhauer. he has read Schopenhauer, and that will influence also the run, both of the Ring Cycle, where he will change the ending, and also the Tristan and Isolde. So the fact that there is that erotic love story with Mathilde is not necessarily because he fell in love first with Mathilde and then wrote Tristan and Isolde, uh-huh, which is the way of doing it, the way most of people talk about it. I do think Tristan and Isolde was this in mind, and he also needed the love story. By the way, he also needed the money of her husband.
Now,
as usual,
yeah,
you know, as long as somebody was paying him, and I know his place in Lucerne. I know Tribschen. I went to listen to Siegfried Idyll in Tribschen.
Really?
Once per year there is a concert, and you know, when you're a guest, you can listen to that concert. It's absolutely extraordinary because he wrote that for the birth of his son with Cosima.
What's very impressive, like he must have been a smooth talker, because he manages regularly to get support or money from the husband, and at the same time he's romancing the wife. Or am I inventing this?
You're not inventing.
Or is it just gossip?
You're not inventing. He was. I mentioned at the very beginning, and on purpose, he was an erotically focused.
That's extraordinary. Yeah. That he was able to get this. Like the husband was as much a fan of him,
absolutely,
of his, as the wife, for different reasons. It's extraordinary. And so he writes Tristan, being supported by Mr. Wissendonck, falls maybe in love after or during, or he needs love, and there she is, and he. If I understood correctly, she was a poet in her own right. She wrote poetry that he sets to music.
I guess he profited a little bit of that.
Okay.
Write poetry. Okay. You know.
Come to my cabin. We'll work on it.
We'll work on it together, yes. So
this
being said, there is a sentence by Wittgenstein.
Yes.
Which I like very much. Wittgenstein, the philosopher of the beginning of the 20th century, whose brother was a pianist, etc., etc. Now, Wittgenstein, about where does inspiration come from? Because finally, this is what we're talking about.
Oh, this is perfect. Yeah, yeah.
And he gives this following example, which I like. A gentleman has eaten all his life potatoes and bacon. He creates something after that. I think if a moment in his life, he creates a work. Which part comes from the bacon and which part comes from the potatoes? Just think about this. So, is it Mina leaving him, because that happened in the beginning? And so, is it this young lady who writes poetry and who's so happy to meet this fabulous personality?
Yeah.
There are all kinds of things that come into what we do when we do it, and when you're a great creator, when you create.
It's perfect.
And, you know, why did Shakespeare compose this, write this work rather than that work? Why did he come to this show? you know...
You just take it, is what
you
you're
just
saying.
Take it. Go to the text and see what is happening and see what it does to you. I mentioned Shakespeare for... And I want to stay on this for a second. Shakespeare nor Wagner have created the situations for their great works. They haven't created... Most of the characters in their works are not created by them. They come from somewhere else. But they transform them. And they make them theirs. We know Tristan and Isolde not because of the books of the medieval times. We know Tristan and Isolde because of Wagner.
And the story, the story comes from 1200.
Like, oh, I know.
600. That blew my mind.
I taught that at university. So
you did?
Yes.
See, that's mind-blowing that he did such a good job of appropriating these two characters that this story that is from the 12th century doesn't exist anymore. It's Wagner's story that exists.
And one of the things in your intervention a few seconds ago that struck me also, and I want to come back to that, he must have been intelligent. Yes, he was. He was very intelligent, and he could sell his things. Luckily, for later, for all those that want to hear opera, he talked to philosophers. His relationship with Nietzsche was a real relationship. These guys talked about space. These guys talked about time.
Space
and time, and what this has to do with human behavior. They knew each other very well, and it's again a woman's story that will divide them. Not necessarily because Nietzsche didn't like Wagner's works and went to Bizet to say how much he became more a philosopher each time he heard Carmen. I do think it was he was rejected by Cosima. He was very much in love with Cosima also. So there's all these things play human roles in the relationship. But the time that these two men talk to each other, I would have loved to sit down and listen to what they said.
Didn't Nietzsche write a book almost exclusively about Wagner?
Of course, yes. Yeah. Yes. And he was a great, he had an enormous knowledge of opera, Nietzsche.
Yeah, that's part of Wagner's...
And most of the friends that surrounded the Wagner group, the groupies, were all very, very intelligent people.
And it's strange that Schopenhauer, the only person that brings out any humility in Wagner is Schopenhauer.
Yeah, but he changes him, he transforms him. The end of the opera is Wagner's, and it's not Schopenhauer's anymore. And the first ending of the, and I can't go into it now, the first ending of the Ring Cycle is Schopenhauer, and Wagner changes it also, because love has to subside. Love has to be the end of it all. I do think I have a text with it. And why don't we don't have at the end of the opera we're talking about, or almost not really talking about, but you know, on which we have focused our talk. Not wealth, not gold, not godly pomp, not house, not garth, nor lordly splendor. Not troubled treaties, treacherous bonds, not smooth-tongued customs, stern decrees, blessed in joy or sorrow, love alone can be. That's the end of Tristan. Love alone can be. And the same thing, what Wagner does, the last tune that ends so slowly and hangs in at the end of Götterdämmerung is the love cry of Sieglinde when she runs away into the woods with, you know, bearing Siegfried and trying to run away from Wotan's wrath. it's extraordinary. And suddenly, and that leitmotif that ends the opera is a part of Brunhilde's love leitmotif. And so, but one has to listen. One has to know what is happening in that music. And you were so right also in the beginning. That is what the essence is about, the essence of the opera.
So this Tristan, the other piece I think that picks me up like that is the Prokofiev Romeo and Juliet.
The
first chord, the way it starts and the way Tristan starts, you know that... The way that he knits this thing so tightly, and you're never resolving, and it's so sad but filled with love. He announces everything, like you said, and you have to hear. I hope that our listeners will just go anywhere and try to hear the opening lines.
So this is interesting what you're saying, because I can have a different. You're right. You're absolutely right. But at the same time, those opening chords of the opera itself, yes, of the opera itself, is the outside world.
Uh-huh.
It's the seaman. It's the seaman. It's daylight. In the opening of the second act, it is Brangaena talking about the sound of the horns far away of the chase. It's the outside world. Okay. The beginning of the last act, it is the pastoral, the flute player of that little boy who is on the island where Tristan finally is lying half dead. He starts the three acts with outside music.
Right.
Because the whole thing of Tristan and Isolde is the opposition of the day, which is the one of troubled treaties, of treacherous bonds, of smooth-tongued customs, of stern decrees. Isn't that something? What is real for love is the night, and that's the second act.
So that's totally Schopenhauer that you're describing.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because
it's only at the end that he changes the Schopenhauer. He doesn't want to give a Schopenhauer an ending to it.
So can you talk a little bit about Schopenhauer? Just take 2 minutes, please. And
what we need with Schopenhauer is the will, the will of living, and that is given to us whatever we want or not. And that, in fact, in this terrible world, because he was a pessimist, in this terrible world, you know, where people die, people are hungry, where, you know, today as much as in the 19th century. And he said that's because of this damn will of living that we have. The ideal thing would be just to be let go. And I'm using words of today. I'm not using it. Let go. In fact, become a kind of, Buddhist. Just let the outside world disappear.
Because it doesn't exist, really.
It doesn't exist, really. So you're getting into that metamorphosis of your own being. And you go. And the only thing that can go with it is death. And so for Tristan und Isolde, you have both of them. No, they have to die. That's why the ambiguity, the wonderful ambiguity of that flask of poison, which is a death potion, which they really want to take in the beginning. They want to go, both of them, to get into that eternity of being, which is love. Do you know that in most of the operas by Wagner, women just fall dead? You know, when they die, they just fall dead. It doesn't give reasons.
No sword, no poison.
They just fall dead. They just die. And you can you have that in different of the operas, in Lohengrin and in others. In the Flying Dutchman also.
Huh.
And Senta goes. I mean, so I've seen all kinds of directors use this for suicide, for all kinds of things, and they're wonderful, you know, visions of that. But in his theater directions, he gave little theater directions in the plays that he was writing. The women just fall. The big difference is that when she comes at the end of the opera, and you have the Liebestod, Liebestod, in one word, love, death, she falls. But it's not on the earth, it's on the body of Tristan. And that is not Schopenhauer. This is love alone can be. So
when
I almost
died,
finished my story now. I almost finished my story.
Yeah.
So you know why does he stop to write the Siegfried?
Do tell.
He decides to write two operas. One is Tristan and Isolde, and the other one, his other comedy. You remember the comedy? The very beginning we were talking about Liebesverbot. Well, there is the second comedy, the Meistersinger von Nürnberg. And it's a very Germanic comedy. It's rather heavy, but it's a rather heavy comedy. I mean, the music is absolutely fascinating. And then after that, he wrote the last act because times had changed also. Mm-hmm. And he said, okay, I'll go for it. You know, the aunt and the nephew will fall in love. And that's the third act of Siegfried. And the music of the third act of Siegfried is so different. The quality of the music, you see that he has spent 10 years writing the Tristan and the Meistersinger, which are absolute masterworks, of course. And I think Tristan more than Meistersinger, but that's another problem. And then at the end of his life, he writes Parsifal. The major words in Tristan is longing, Sehnen in German. This is the focal concept of Tristan. It's longing, longing to die, longing to get rid of that outside world. And I think he suffered from that outside world. In debts, and running away, and, you know, and being poor, and being in storms, and having to fight for everything. You know, whatever his character. He said it all in that Tristan. So it's longing. Then with Parsifal, he comes to compassion. And that is Mitleid in German. So the word Mitleid comes so often back in Offenbach. That's funny. No, not the composer, but comes back so often in Tristan, Parsifal, Mitleid.
Mitleid,
compassion. And as much as the word longing comes in Tristan and Isolde. And you see, the year afterwards, you know, he dies in 93.
83, maybe.
I'm sure you're right. 69 years old. So 70. It's 83. You're so right. He dies in 83. Sorry about that. I was thinking of Brahms, who was in 96. I was, why do all these thoughts come through our minds at the time you're trying to talk about Wagner? So, 83. He loved Venice, and he's in Palace Vendôme. And the day before he dies, he's writing. He's writing a text. And the last words are the end. He just recalls an extraordinary ending of the second Faust by Goethe, which his father-in-law had used for his Faust symphony, Franz Liszt. And the last words he wrote down is das ewig Weibliche. The eternal feminine. That was in his mind. So you will have at the during the concerts, we won't have the whole opera, of course. It's rather difficult. I have heard excerpts, the second act especially, done as concert version. You only need three singers. Basically, you don't need too many singers anyhow, and you can cut a certain number of things, which I don't like. But this is what the orchestra is going to present is a suite, a musical suite out of Tristan and Isolde. And the composer Wagner, who has done good work also on the suite on the Ring Cycle, it's easier on the Ring Cycle, has produced this work. It will help people listen to the music and not follow the action and let them be taken by that extraordinary music. There are things that one misses, of course, because you will miss the voices. And the words are so important within the music, you know, that resonate within the music, that one misses the action as such is secondary, in my opinion. But one day the orchestra should do the second act of Tristan und Isolde and have
that
this.
That would be wonderful.
Would be an extraordinary production. So there you go. There you go. I think you had something wonderful to tell me and to round up this plunging into Wagner's world.
What I discovered, the personal life of Wagner, chasing women, chasing money, borrowing money, owing money all the time, being an anti-Semite, even more than his anti-Semitic friends, he was very outspoken about this. So I found a quote which I like very much and which might explain why you should, if you love Wagner, just say it out loud. And it's something that a Jewish man who had the right way to look at Wagner and the money, and he had lent money to Wagner, and so this man who is the great 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 uncle of Rudolf Saber, who's a writer, says, "I've given him a lot of money. He hardly said thank you. I told him I couldn't help being a Jew, and he called me Shylock. You see, my friends, the world is full of people who borrow and don't repay, who steal other men's wives, daughters, and sweethearts. But only one of them wrote Tristan. I only hope my children and their children will not listen to me when old age might make me bitter, but will listen to his music." There it is. And that's what...
I mean, while you were saying that, I would come back to finish also again... You know, let's not forget, love alone can be. That's one thing. And then of an American author, this incredible sentence, there is the country of the living and the country of the death. And the bridge between the two is love.
That's the right thought to end on. Jean-Jacques? Thanks again. We've been meeting together for a whole season. This is the last podcast of this season. It was such a great pleasure to meet you on the bridge.
Thank you. Thank you.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.